folks, how you doing? We're here with Tom Ryan from Total Mind Dynamics, and today we're going to talk about sovereignty. Tom, would you mind introducing yourself to the people at home?
Well, people might wonder why I'm talking about sovereignty, because I'm a hypnotherapist, but actually hypnotherapy is about freeing people's minds. I mean, you have psychotherapists, psychoanalysts, psycho this, psycho that, psycho the other thing. It's all about the conscious mind. Hypnotherapy is about the subconscious mind. That's where freedom lies. Freedom is sovereignty. Well, true sovereignty is even beyond freedom, because it's recognizing your own worth, your own value, your own God self, if you like, a sovereign self, which is that you're equal to all men and there's nobody superior to you, no matter what their title, no matter what their status or anything else is. You are equal to them. Once you know that, you can deal with them in a better way instead of being subservient to anybody. When we're subservient, we're letting ourselves down. But anyway, as I said, I'm a hypnotherapist, and my main area of work, a lot of it, is helping people to stop smoking. And the reason so many people want to stop smoking nowadays actually is not for health reasons, it's for financial reasons, because 20 cigarettes a day is about 3,600 euros a year. And because of the squeeze financially on people, they very much want to do that. Of course, it has the added benefit of adding years to their life, life to the years, and quality to their life. But the biggest problem people seem to have is anxiety, panic attacks, all that kind of thing. Now, I see them doing all kinds of strange things, such as CBT and what they could do. There's so many different therapies. But, I mean, one proper session of hypnotherapy with a breathing exercise from Buteyko can get rid of anxiety straight away, because that's an overactive fight or flight response. That's easy to solve at a subconscious level. You can talk to the conscious mind until doomsday. It won't get the message to the subconscious mind, because that's blocked by what we call a filtering system. And unfortunately, the world we live in, everything that's worthwhile is filtered out, because we're conditioned from childhood to believe this, to believe that, to believe all kinds of things. Those beliefs, each and every one of them, is a lie. B-E to B, L-I-E, lied to. And we won't say what the F's about. So beliefs are lies. And while you live in a place of beliefs, you're imprisoning yourself within the concepts. Now, there's one thing that will help you to recognize a belief from something you know. Every belief has a fear attached to it. The fear keeps it in place. If I don't do this, oh my God, what's going to happen? That's the fear attachment to a belief. So the difference between knowing and believing is fear. And the belief always comes from the outside. Knowing comes from within your own heart. And that's the most important thing. So I practice all over Europe. I train hypnosis to people in Poland, Croatia, I'll be doing Slovenia and Serbia and other places. I work through an interpreter, obviously, in those countries. I don't speak the languages, unfortunately. But we're working in an area that's growing. But no government and no university institution would really put hypnotherapy in there with psychology, because they don't want people to be sovereign. They want people to be subservient. They want people to obey the master, because they're part of the system of the master. And that system, to perpetuate itself, can't afford to allow people to discover their own sovereignty within.
Why do you think people are so comfortable with that kind of setup, with that kind of dynamic?
Well, you see, when we're very small children, we're totally dependent on our parents for warmth, for comfort, for food, for life, for love, for everything. Now, when we go 4 or 5, that's transferred to the school, but it gets more insidious then. When you're a little child in school, you want to go to the toilet. You didn't have to ask mommy to go to the toilet, but in school you have to put your hand up and ask to go to the toilet. If you have to ask to go to do something so simple like that, you're becoming a slave from that moment onward. From the very first time you have to ask to go to the toilet, your mind has been enslaved, and you're getting into a belief system that there are superior people, adults, persons to you. Now, the problem is that becomes ingrained in the mind. It becomes into a belief system. Then we're insidiously frightened with religion, hell, damnation, all this kind of thing, which is basically another control mechanism. then the stuff we're taught in school is not necessarily correct. We're taught basic things that seem right, particularly the history, is a complete pack of lies. And I mean, that's the only thing you can really call it, lies. Let's be straight about it. Most of the stuff we're taught in school and the way we're taught in school has absolutely no benefit in life outside. Learning to read and write, fine, that is beneficial. Learning mathematics, that is beneficial. Maybe learning a language. But beyond that, nearly all of what we learn in school is there for the benefit of the teacher to fill in the time and for the control and to get us subservient to the system. Okay, you take history in school, for example. It's his story. Who is he? He is the controller, the mechanizer. It's not the story of truth. History was written by the winners of the wars, or the people who are in control at any given moment in time. It's got absolutely nothing to do with truth. That's one example. Now, why are people so satisfied, comfortable in their zone? Well, we have a thing called a comfort zone. For us to actually survive, we've got to try and create as much comfort for ourselves as possible. You see, the human being moves away from pain and suffering, anxiety, fear, and from things that would make them feel insecure. They move towards comfort and happiness and warmth, food, love, nurturing. They move towards that. That's the natural state of the human being. Now, when there's a falsehood put into that, we fall into the falsehood of the comfort zone. Give you an example of the comfort zone. Somebody goes to a doctor and he puts them on some kind of a pill for something. 6 months later, they're still on the pill. 10 years later, they're still on the pill. Well, why are they on the pill 10 years later, or even 6 months later? Isn't it supposed to cure something? But it's not curing anything. So why are they taking it 10 years later? Well, if they look at the side effects of the thing, it's probably doing an enormous amount of damage, and the original situation probably doesn't exist anymore. They're in a comfort zone. Oh, the comfort of the pill, oh, the doctor's right. Take my pill. That's a comfort zone. Another comfort zone is not growing beyond the age of 12. Most human beings, most adults, internationally, worldwide, don't actually mature beyond the age of 12. They never quite get into puberty, believe it or not. Well, they act sexually, but there's no puberty, and there's no intellectual puberty involved in that. At that age, you see, they have masters. The local policeman, the local teacher, mommy and daddy, the local authorities, the national authorities. There's always somebody and a whole hierarchy of systems above them. And they feel that they're the tiny little rung instead of being a totally sovereign being. They don't recognize their own sovereignty. It's bred out of them by the teaching, by the false learning, by the education, which isn't really education. In fact, it could be called indoctrination, because a huge amount of it is indoctrination. And that indoctrination, unfortunately, is never questioned by the people. First of all, we're too young to question it. And then it becomes so ingrained that we accept it as the norm, and therefore it never arises to question it again. A few people wake up, they question it, but most people don't. And most of the time when people in fact do question it is because they've had a wake-up experience. Something horrific has happened in their life. They can't pay the mortgage anymore, they're going to be divorced or something like that, and all of a sudden they start asking why, how, what. Where did all this come from? Why do I find myself in this situation? And all of a sudden, the whole edifice of the belief system starts to fall down. Then people begin to wake up. Now, we're in a stage of humanity where there's a huge wake-up call, because the banking system that people trusted is robbing them. They always thought Billy the Kid was the robber, not the banker. Well, Billy the Kid is a harmless, poor little fellow out there. It's a kid playing cowboys. The banker inside is the real criminal. Now people are waking up to that. We always thought the doctor was going to be our health, but now there's vaccines given out that are turning children into unfortunate, terribly, painfully autistic children. That didn't exist before vaccine. And there's so many more problems being created. So now you can't trust your doctor. You can't trust your banker. Can you trust your priest? No, he's likely to molest your children. So who can you trust? You cannot trust anybody. Can you trust a politician? No, he made a whole lot of promises before the election. Is he keeping them? He's doing the very opposite now. So you can't trust him either. So all of a sudden, the belief systems are broken down because the trust attached to them isn't standing up to scrutiny. So you can't trust any of those things. So really then, who can you trust? Well, you got to grow up, be an adult, discover your sovereignty, and trust yourself. And when you do that, you're not likely to let yourself down. When you attach to your sovereignty, you won't hurt any man and you won't let any man hurt you, but you won't lie to yourself. And now you're starting from a place of truth. And the only truth comes from within. You're not going to get it from any politician, from any doctor, from any accountant, from any lawyer, from any professional of any description, because the professions are there. All professions, let's be honest about it, are parasitic. They're there to get money out of you. They're there to your sweat and blood keeps them going. That's what a profession is there for, to suck that money out of you. So that's what the profession. So all professions are, as I said already, parasitic. So we've got to become sovereign beings. We become the real, true, professional sovereign from within at that point. So this comfort zone place has to be replaced by something much more powerful, much stronger, our own inner knowing, our own inner sovereignty, where we can stand tall and be proud of who we are ourselves and be subservient to no man and be equal to every man or woman.
Okay, thanks for that, Tom. I have a question for you, though. Like, from your perspective, is there a set way of behaving as a sovereign?
Well, the first part of the behaviour as a sovereign is to love and approve of yourself, like I say. The second part of the behaviour of a sovereign is very simple. And that's different for every person, remember. But there's a common denominator. When you're a sovereign, you stand on your own two feet in your own sovereignty. That means you must respect every other human being, whether they have sovereignty with them or not, have a right to that. So you never harm any other human being. You take on great responsibility by being a sovereign. Do no harm to anybody else, as you would that men should do to you, to them, kind of thing. So that's the first part of sovereignty. The second part of sovereignty then is to detach yourself from the controlling systems as much as possible. If you've a bit of ground in the back or the front, start growing your own vegetables. Don't go running down to the supermarket and getting ones that are poisoned with a whole lot of toxic chemicals, such as Roundup. Grow your own vegetables if you can. Detach as much as possible. If you have a heating system, get in a solid fuel central heating and deal with somebody that can give you the fuel rather than to be dependent on oil or gas. Because I promise you, the day that oil will come when neither the oil, the gas, or the electricity will be available for strike or for whatever other reason. If you have a local supplier or a local or a personal supplier, that will never happen. This is part of sovereignty, is to protect yourself from the times and the tides and the ups and the downs of the social structure. The social structure is letting everybody down at the moment, in the banking system, in the medical system, in the legal system. The whole lot is a lie, it's a con, it's a scam. Your sovereignty, there's no lies in there, there's only truth. And the further that you remove yourself, in the beginning it's impossible, because there's a guy in Australia that's completely gone off out into the wilds and is living in some kind of awful state. This is not sensible either. You got to do it in stages. Move yourself back as much as possible. Take what you can from the system, but move yourself back from the system as much as possible and give as little to the system as you can. And you will feel your sovereignty when you have good fresh vegetables, when you have truth coming from within, when you're equal to every other man, and when you have honesty and integrity coming from yourself and you do no harm to anybody and you never allow the situation for anybody to do harm to you. This is a good place to be in. That's sovereignty. So there's different ways for different people to do that. But essentially, the idea behind it and the thoughts behind it are the same, while the actions may not be.
Tom, just in relation to a point you made earlier on about sovereignty, and, you know, maybe some people they might shy a little bit away from what they think would be responsibility, or you know, leaning on to others and telling them how they should behave. What about people who are maybe a little bit shy, or you know, are meek in their outlook? How would you kind of explain sovereignty or the mindset to them?
Well, you see, true sovereignty to them is the right to be that way without people bullying them or taking advantage of them or using them as doormats when they're that way. They have a right to be in their own quiet and peaceful place. They have a right not to want to be involved, say, in the political thing, or involved in any kind of a conflict, or involved in even any kind of conversations or anything else about it, to live their own quiet life, their own quiet way, in their own quiet peace. That's a beautiful expression of sovereignty. And they should be very proud to be in that place of sovereignty. But one of the things that poor people, unfortunately, and when I say poor, I'm talking about poor from the point of view of not financially poor or poor from any other point and other than that, when people see them in that place, they think they have a right to take advantage of them. They do not have a right to take advantage of them. So the only thing they need to do is be in their sovereignty to the extent that they do not let others abuse them. They do not let others take advantage of them. They do not let others walk all over them. That they do not let others manipulate them, control them. That's the only bit of sovereignty they need. And then, you know, that's really what they want. And that's what they're entitled to. And if they look at the mirror first thing every morning, last thing every night, their name, I love and approve of you unconditionally, that's a lovely, quiet and gentle way to take it back. And bit by bit they come into their power. They won't allow people to bully them. They won't allow people to abuse and manipulate them. And that's the kind of sovereignty they want. And that's as important or as good as any other kind of sovereignty. And they're also people who could have their own little garden, their own little vegetable patch, and delight in doing things like that without having any recourse to anything or anybody else. That's beautiful, true sovereignty. And these people are really the salt of the earth. Gentle, nice, decent, honest people that never harm anybody. So the important thing is for them not to allow themselves to be harmed by others who see that as weakness when it's not really. It's sovereignty being expressed in their own personal way. It's not weakness. And it's not to be abused. And it shouldn't be abused. The only thing they need to learn is to not allow others to use it as if it were a weakness and to use it as an opportunity to abuse them.
Tom, it's a very big subject, sovereignty, and there's a lot of different perspectives to it. We've kind of talked about people who are kind of a little bit meek in their outlook and how that shouldn't be confused with weakness. And we also maybe talk about, you know, people who might not fully understand it or, you know, might just be sitting a little bit on the fence as regards this information.
They would, I suppose, be considered to be like the people who are the I don't knows when they're doing these opinion poll things. And it's okay not to know, but it's not okay to remain not knowing. And the only thing you need to do to learn to know is to ask questions. You don't have to go off and carry banners or do anything about it, but please ask questions. Ask questions from all sides. I'm not suggesting you only ask questions from people who are talking about sovereignty. Ask questions from everybody. Then find out or notice what resonates with your heart inside. And if it resonates with your heart inside, it's coming from your truth, and I think that's what you should follow. I'm not telling you what that is because I don't know. People, as we say, sitting on the fence, if you like, they have children. A lot of them have children anyway. Now, are they sitting on the fence when their children need direction, support, power, help, and leadership, and parental guidance, if you like? Because if they are, where are their children going to end up? If you're sitting on the fence, for God's sake, ask yourself questions. Ask yourself how you can help your children. And ask yourself, do you want your children to be in a place where they have less power than you have, and you have less power than your parents had? And there'll be less and less power, less and less help, less and help support. They're being squeezed. You're being squeezed right now. And there's no let up on this squeezing, and there'll be more and more and more Do you want them to be totally the life, the joy, the happiness, the peace, the opportunities? Do you want to squeeze out of them? For example, a lot of parents are very upset and very worried at the moment. They're educating their children, they're looking after their children, they're doing wonderful things for their children. For they're getting an aeroplane, end up in Australia, Canada, America, God knows where. That was never their intention when they had children. They weren't breeding immigrants, they were breeding children. So I think it's very, very important for parents, when it comes to their children, to get off the fence, to make life as helpful, as supportive as possible for them as children, but to do their utmost to provide an opportunity for them to be able to live and earn a living in their own country, which in fact is their birthright. That's been taken away from them by greedy, stupid people, bankers, politicians, bondholders, call them whatever you like. They don't give a damn about you and your children. They're not sitting in the fence. Their hand is in your pocket. And while you're sitting in the fence, your pockets have been emptied. So I can understand the meek people. They're in a good place. They're on nice meek place. And they have their own power in that place and their own sovereignty. But the people sitting on the fence, they have no sovereignty. Because not only are they giving away their sovereignty, they're giving away the sovereignty of their children. This is a terrible thing to do. This is shortchanging their own children. What a terrible thing to do. I don't think anybody wants to do that. And if people think about it like that, they won't be sitting on the fence. I'm not telling them what to do. I'm just saying they should do the very best they can for their children, to give them the best opportunity they can in life, and to give them the opportunity, if at all possible, to be able to live and work in their own country, so they may even be able to see their grandchildren one day. Not just see them in Skype in some other part of the world, or have to visit them once every 2 or 3 years, if they can afford it by then. Because if there's any money left, they might be able to visit them, and if there's not, they won't. That's what the world is coming to. And if we allow that to continue, it's not getting any better. It's getting steadily worse. Through my entire lifetime, I haven't seen it ever getting any better. But there's more and more constriction on people all the time. And the people who are going to suffer the most are the children. Because by the time they grow up, it's going to be a virtual prison. And probably a foreign one into that. Where they'll never see their grandchildren. Who wants that? Get off the fence. And the biggest problem I find that people have, apart from wanting to stop smoking or things like that, is they're not in their power. They're not scripting their life. It's been scripted for them. See, when we go to school, we learn how to respond to commands and to be controlled and to be part of a group. And our individuality is broken down by that. And people learn not to script their lives anymore. They're doing what they're told. You do your homework, you do this, you stand up when I say, you sit down when I say, you have to ask to go through the toilet. This is taking the power away. It's something that needs to be addressed and will be in the future, I'm pretty certain. Because take the United States, for example. The biggest fear in the entire United States among people as individuals, and this is well documented, is the fear of standing up and speaking in public. That's because of all the times they've been ridiculed in school. So every time they stood up as a child to speak, they were put down. So, and in fact, that's not just the United States, but we have statistics from there, but pretty much the whole white world. When you ask people to stand up and talk, you'll see the shiver, you'll see the anxiety, you'll see the fear, you'll see people avoiding it. And they have as much right to stand up and talk, and they have as much to say and as much to offer, and maybe more than those people who do stand up. So it's very, very important for people to be in their power. Now, to be in one's power is to be in a place where you have complete self-approval on the inside, self-love on the inside, self-respect on the inside. That makes you a person of character. I was going to write a book about character one time, and I decided to research it and look up things about character. You know what? The only reference I found to character was in Hamlet. from Shakespeare. And the old guy's given the advice. And that's the only reference I could find it to anywhere. Look it up, Google character, you'll find nothing. That's the very first thing that we should be taught in school. But you see, when you give people character, when you express character to people, you're giving them their power. There's a power war going on, and it's been going on through society for probably ever. And it's between the people who want to control and the masses of the people themselves. Because you see, the power is a sovereign thing within each person. We are sovereigns. What is a sovereign? A person with their own truth, their own integrity, and their own self-respect. And that's the first thing that's taken away from people. And when that's taken away from people, they're out of their power. They're no longer scripting their lives. The loss of script starts very, very early in life, because little children have dreams, beautiful dreams. They have all kinds of amazing dreams and fantasizing dreams, but they're all excited about the dreams, and they have fabulous and wonderful excitement about their dreams. What happens to those dreams? Shut up, don't be silly. They get all this kind of a thing, not from people trying to put them down or anything, but from people whose dreams have been destroyed when they were children. So when their dreams were destroyed when they were children, they see the little children coming along with it again, and they're now in the place where they're given a natural reaction that they've developed over periods of time through habitual means to do the same to the children that was done to them. They're just repeating it generation after generation, and they're playing into the hands of those who want to control us all. And there's a smaller and smaller cabal of very psychopathic people who want to control everybody. You'll see that in every government, everywhere. This whole governmental structure is dangerous. And we say, oh, but we have democracy. Do we really? I mean, if you want to choose between Tweedledum and Tweedledummer and call that democracy, that's fine. But you look at the last two Irish governments. They're promises they gave us, and people voted based on those promises. And when you vote, what do? You bequeath your sovereignty for the period of time that they're in power, for them to use your sovereignty for the governing of the people and the country. And what are they doing with it? They're robbing everybody's blind. They're robbing everybody blind. In fact, they have their hand in your pocket right now. They have their hand in everybody's pocket right now. And they're squeezing every last bit of everything they can out of it. What are they doing? They're giving it to the bankers. They're giving it to people they call bondholders. People who have infinite riches don't need it. But the poor people are starving to pay the people who don't need. And we call that democracy? I don't think so. We had democracy in Ireland once. It was way back in the time when we had tuathas. A tuatha is a self-contained community governed by a petty king or the head of a clan. And the legal system was run by the brans. And they had no such thing as criminal law. It was all a form of civil law. In fact, the legal, say a court sitting, would be more like two people being brought together to trash out their problems and find a solution within them. And if they didn't, then and only then would the brand impose a solution on one or the other. And the Irish people loved and respected their law so much, that's documented way back even in Roman writing, that they loved the law. Now, do the people love the law now? I mean, you're going down the road, you're 3 or 4 miles above the speed limit, and you get that parking ticket and you get penalty points. You park in the public street and you're fined from parking there because you ran a few minutes over what a bloody meter told you you should be. This isn't law. And when they tell you you have to pay for the water, which is a God-given right to every human being, this gets ridiculous. In fact, there's a new law coming out in Spain. You'll have to pay for sunlight. In other words, they are banning people from putting up these, these
solar panels
and things like that in Spain, because they want all the money to go to the big corporations that are supplying the electricity and charging what they like for it. This is getting ridiculous. You can't collect rainwater in parts of the United States now. It's illegal. But when law gets like that, this is not law anymore. This is abuse of the highest order. And it's getting like that every place. And people's power has been taken away more and more and more. Thank you.
Tom, you spoke earlier about the fact that it's quite important that people take back their power. Could you elaborate a little bit more on that, please?
I can. In fact, the whole idea of taking back one's power came to me in an interesting way about 20-odd years ago, when I was fairly new, well, compared to now anyway, at what I do. And this lady came to me and she said she didn't want to stop smoking or give up drink or lose weight or didn't have fears, phobias, anxieties, panic attacks or all these usual things I deal with. And I said, what are you doing here then? She said, I want to change the world. Well, fortunately for me, this was a consultation and she was to come back then and I was to start working with her. I was totally flummoxed by this. Oh, she's going to change the world. What's she going to do? Become some kind of supreme ruler or things like that. This is the train of thought that was going through my mind. So I went away and I looked up and I studied things. Remember, there wasn't any internet and there was no Googling in those days. So it was quite difficult. But I eventually came across this book by somebody and it said, you take back, or you change the world from the inside by changing yourself. And you change yourself from the inside, you start to influence the world on the outside. And that's how you change the world. So when she came back, I was ready, willing, and able to work with her. And she was delighted with the results and responses. She became a very, very successful person in business afterwards. But it was all about taking back your power. Now, it's easy enough for me to say, take back your power and all this kind of thing. But what does it mean? How can people do it? Because it's until you do it, it's nothing more than an aspiration. And an aspiration that's unfulfilled becomes a frustration. And then a frustration leads to all kinds of misery. So the way to take back your power, you start on the inside. Very simple. You start changing your personal relationship to yourself. You get in touch with your power. How do you do that? Very, very simple little exercise, and people find it difficult, but it's very simple. You get your dressing table mirror, your bathroom mirror, or some whatever mirror that you're likely to see. If it's a lady, if you're doing your makeup in the mornings, or a gentleman if he's shaving himself, you put a couple of little X's, one up on the left-hand corner, one up on the right-hand corner. If the girls want to be a little bit romantic, they can put love hearts in it. But you look at that first thing every morning and you state your name, followed by the words, I love and approve of you unconditionally. You do that first thing every morning, you do that first thing every night. You immediately walk away from the mirror, you don't engage with it any further. Now, when you do that, you'll find that's pretty awkward. Because it's gone completely against the grain of what nearly everybody is doing all the time when they look in the mirror. Because the first thing they do is they criticize, oh my God, look at the state of myself this morning. I've got spots, or I've got my eyes, or I've got lines, or I've got this, or I've got that, or I've got the other thing, or I'm going bald, or I'm going whatever. It's always criticism. So the mirror image is always reflecting back massive amounts of criticism. Now all of a sudden you're changing that radically, totally transforming it to I love and approve of you unconditionally. You don't say I love and approve of me unconditionally, that's talking to yourself, that's kind of ignoring the mirror. It's the mirror image. You say it to the mirror image. State your name, followed by the words I love and approve of you unconditionally, because it's reflecting it back millions of times as you repeat that just for those few seconds. You do that first thing every morning, last thing every night. Now what are you doing? You're putting into the bank of, you call it your self-approval bank. You're putting a deposit into that every morning and every night. After 3 or 4 weeks, it begins to resonate with you. And then when you say negative things to yourself, they don't resonate with you anymore. You have transformed things. But then when you become challenged, say 6 months, year, 5 years, 10 years from now, providing you do this every day, people say, oh, well, how long do I have to do this? Well, what's wrong with doing it every day for the rest of your life? What better can you do? But I don't have to do this for life, somebody would say. But you do have to eat, don't you? You have to go to the toilet. You have to do it every day. Now you have to shave. Girls tend to put on their makeup every day. You comb your hair every day. So what's the big problem about looking at the mirror saying, I love and approve of you unconditionally every day? You do it every day, twice a day, first thing in the morning, last thing at night for the rest of your life. Now, the impact that has is massive. Let's assume you're challenged 6 months. Let's assume your very being is challenged in some way. That will come up and resonate from deep within. Draw out everything you have in that account and use it to protect yourself against whatever attacks being made on you. When you look into your account having done that and put back what you haven't used, you'll find you're putting back everything, but what was in there already is still there. So you're actually doubling what's in the account by defending yourself in that way. Then people will say to me, but I do that in another way. I look after my self-esteem. I said, that's not doing it in another way. That's what very, very bad therapeutic processes recommend. Because what's self-esteem? Self-esteem is kind of a little bit like armor on the outside. It's a protective shield from the outside you put around yourself. There's people who can always find ways through that. I tell people self-esteem is like a balloon or a virgin, one prick and it's gone. Because self-esteem has no depth and no substance, it's on the outside. But self-love and approval comes from deep within your heart. That's unassailable. So that's why it's so important. Now, that leads to character, that leads to your own truth, that leads to power, personal power. When you get into your power then, you exercise that power in the simplest way possible, by asking questions. What kind of questions do you ask? Well, you see a headline in the paper. Is this true? Why would they write that? Who's gaining from it? Why aren't bankers arrested? Why are petty criminals put in jail and big criminals let free? Why is white-collar crime never dealt with efficiently? And the answers start coming from the inside, because the people that are making the laws for the to a larger extent are the white-collar criminals. And you just look at what they're doing, but don't get mad at them. Get even. Get even by taking back your power. You do that, first of all, by disengaging from them. You disengage from them in every way you can. Avoid parking your car where you have to pay for a parking meter. Don't give them that money. Avoid everything that you can avoid that has to give them money. Avoid contracting with them in any way, shape or form. Because anytime you have to give them money, you have to contract with them. Because unless a service is provided that you request, there's no contract. And nobody can ask you for money for a service that you haven't contracted for or requested. However, if you contract with them, then they've got you. Then they own you, legally and in every other way. So you do not contract. So start working with different ways not to contract. Harry will tell you that in his videos. I suggest you look at them, because he's a genius in that area. So do not contract with the current people in power. Now, the sovereignty of a country, let's talk about that different. The first kind of sovereignty is our own personal sovereignty. The second important sovereignty then is the sovereignty of the country. We think when we vote for people, they're our sovereign leaders. Well, you see, leaders lead from the front. Like, for example, if they're creating a thing called austerity, the first thing they do is they wear a hair shirt and they give up all their salary and all their wages and everything and they lead from the front. These would be wonderful leaders, but do you see them doing that? You do not see them doing that. They're not leading from the front, therefore they're not leaders, they're just parasites. So avoid giving your power to parasites by disengaging from them.
Politics, more than one parasite.
Yeah, a tick is a bloodsucker. A tick is a parasite. Politics is the whole lot of the politicians and the parasites put together. Now, we're working with a currency that we use as money called the euro. We have no control over that, and, you know, the people who control the money are the people who control the sovereignty of any country. We have no sovereignty in this country of any description. None. The only way we're going to take... Now, the important thing for people to know is there's no authority greater than the authority that comes from within. That is your own sacred sovereignty. That's the meaning of free will choice. And anytime your free will choice has been taken away from you, take back your sovereignty. Don't contract with anybody who wants to take your free will choice away from you. Be very careful about signing any documents for anybody, because they're basically asking you, for the most part, to give away your sovereignty. When you vote for people, that's your sovereignty that's putting them in power. Then they don't become answerable to you anymore and they go off on a tangent. Now, we have to create a new law. We, the people, have to create a new law, and it's going to be our law. Before you vote for anybody in future, I'm going to put together a document with some other people, and you ask anybody who asks you for your vote to sign this document. The document will simply state that I guarantee that all promises I made will be fulfilled, and if there's not a substantial amount of them fulfilled within the first 100 days of my election, I bequeath my seat back to the people for a by-election. We'll ask them to sign that before we vote for them. We'd probably end up voting for nobody, but that's, don't worry about that. They tell you you have violated democracy then. You haven't. You have put democracy back in charge, because democracy is your sovereign power being expressed through you, not through anybody else. And if there's nobody elected, we can have another election. We can put up sovereign people who will sign such a document. This is the first step to taking back your sovereignty. The second step to taking back your sovereignty is to create our own sovereign currency. Now, there's a group of people, honourable people, creating a new bank with a new currency called the Era Bank, with a new currency called the Era. It'll initially be, they will have coins for even very high denominations, and it can be done internet sort of trading, if you like, on it. But this is going to be very important. And each euro will be worth an era, and you can exchange one for the other. But the whole idea is, bit by bit, all the euros will be withdrawn and replaced by the era. When we have all those billions of euros withdrawn, we can talk to the European Central Bank from a place of power then. We can choose to give them those euros, and we can choose not to give them to them. Or we can choose to do what we like with them. We're in the driving seat when we're in control of our own currency, and only then. We have no control now. Our government is like a Mickey Mouse County Council pretending to govern, and all it's doing is taking more and more money out of your pocket to give it away to the people who really are in power. So take back your sovereignty. Start writing your script from the inside. Anybody asks you a question or tells you to do something or commands you to do something or requests you to do something, ask yourself, is this in my best interest? Is this rewarding me for what I do? Is this worth my while? If it's not, you might not immediately be in a position to walk away from it like it's your job or something like that. But bit by bit, as you take back your sovereignty, you'll find better ways to do things. Bit by bit, you'll find ways to start maybe working for yourself. Everybody should be growing their own vegetables, whether you have to hire a little allotment or whether you have a bit of ground yourself. You won't have to pay any VAT for those vegetables. You won't have to spray any poisonous Roundup-like toxins that'll give you cancer on them either. You can have beautiful, fresh, organic vegetables. When I tell people to eat organic vegetables, they say, oh, they're too expensive. I say, it don't cost you anything, just the price of the seeds. Grow them. Learn to grow them. Love learning to grow them. Love learning to take back your power, because it's magnificent when you do it. And you'll feel so good when you do it. And you'll be so powerful when you do it. And then connect with other sovereigns and create a sovereign community of people. And this grows stronger, stronger and stronger. And we're back to the two heads again. And every so often you can elect a leader, but a leader who is only empowered by the people and can be withdrawn from that power anytime he or she does not fulfill their role for which they have agreed to do. So this is where the power of the future is. It's like going back to the old Druidic times, to the old times when we had bards, and to the old times when we had the Brehans, and when we had the leader of the Tuatha, which was either the leader of the clan or the pretty king, and then we had not quite a hierarchical system. If you look at the ancient Irish system, it wasn't hierarchical.
There's another group of people out there that I want to actually talk about briefly, and it's about people when you initially come across the information of sovereignty and you think it's quite important. You do it and you try and share it with people. And unfortunately, you may come across a certain group of people who can be quite dismissive or offensive even about the concept. Would you mind giving your musings on what their motivation might be or what their particular perspective on it would be?
The best way to look at that is think of when you were going to school.
Think of your class.
Was there a bully in the class? There likely was.
You'll find that there was a few people then that really were basically ass-lickers for that bully and hanging around that bully and feeding off that bully and feeling safe within the confines of that bully and letting that bully run the power and not bothering or caring about how that bully harmed or hurt other people and in fact helping the bully to hurt other people. They're the kind of dismissive people. Actually, I came across a situation of that where a man put up something very, very interesting and very salient about the economic situation and about economists. You see, economists are people who should always go and have a rest for themselves because they're the people who helped to create the situation as it is. And they still stand up and they tell us how to solve the problems they have created. The people who create the problems never solve the problems. They should be dismissed out of the solution base altogether. But getting back to those followers of bullies, because essentially that's what they are. They like throwing names and accusations at people and ridiculing people because they don't have anything intelligent to offer to any of those pieces of information that are offered to them. So the only thing they can do is ridicule them, put them down, call you a conspiracy theorist or something like that. They'll throw a name at you. We've had them throughout history. Years and years ago, they would refer to them as communists or atheists. Now they're conspiracy theorists. Go back further, they'd have burned them at the stake at the Inquisition or something like that. They're quite evil in their thinking because they're followers of the class bully. And who is the class bully at the moment? The class bully is the government. Because the government is simply playing class bully because the teacher of the class, or if you like, the head of that, is somebody in Brussels. Or someplace else, or in some bloody bank in New York, or wherever, and the bully is the government. And they're the government followers. They're the ones who support all of this. Are they going to lose any sleep if somebody down the road loses their house? They'll probably say it was good enough for them. They'll probably say they were freeloaders. They'll never take into account that those people were fooled and lied to by banks, unscrupulous banks and bankers who offer them money way beyond anything that they should have been given because there were certain constraints on what amount of money was supposed to be giving out, completely ignored by the banks. Then the sellers, the estate agents, took every opportunity to squeeze every last penny they could, and it had nothing to do with the value of anything. You see, they didn't know the value of anything. They knew the price of everything. And the people who are the class bullies, they're a little bit like that from a different point of view. They're not the price of everything and the value of nothing. All they can do is follow whatever, whoever is in power and dismiss everything else. Now, there's no point in arguing with them because you can't hold an argument with them because they won't engage in an argument with them. All they do is that they call names to people. Remember, the class bully is probably one of the lowest things you can imagine in society. And they're one step lower than that. And that's about as low as you can go. And there's no point in arguing with them, there's no point in talking to them. Just get away from them, get out of their company. Don't have anything to do with them and don't engage with them.
The tragedy of it is, though, as I've seen myself, is that quite often they're, you know, will be quote classified as what you would call quite intelligent.
Sorry, what was that?
The tragedy of it is, would be quite often what you would think as reasonably intellectual people, right? If you were to try and engage them, you might present some information saying this will be worthy of your interest, but it just gets dismissed out of hand. Is that more so because of a belief base, or is that because of the decisions that they have aligned themselves with the bully?
They've aligned themselves with the bully, number one. They're not as intelligent as they present themselves to be, number two. Three, they probably put themselves up in a little place in society and they think that this kind of activity and dismissive of everybody else lifts them up a little bit. In other words, they're crawling up the rungs of society on the backs of other people, the hurt, the pain of other people. And they have to dismiss everything else. They're the people you'll find that become very right-wing, become kind of fascist and Nazi in their outlook. People who become racist. And you know, it already all comes from fear within, because they're afraid of their own power. They have to follow the bully, because the only sense of power they have is what they get from the bully, and by hanging on to the bully, the coattails of the bully, as in this instance, the government. That's their source of power. There is no power within. So you can't argue with them, because they won't engage in an argument with them, because they don't have any arguments. But they have attacks and put-downs. And they may appear to be reasonable while you're agreeing with them. The minute you disagree with them, their ego comes up and it explodes great, like a great big balloon all about them. And it becomes powerful because, you see, when you're suggesting something different from what they're doing, they take it as a personal attack. Everything is personal with them. Everything is a personal attack. In fact, none of it really is. It's not about the person. It's about each individual taking back their power. But if you talk about taking back your power to them, they look at you as if you've got some kind of disease, like CJD or something like that. Not CJH, CJD. And they think you've got Alzheimer's disease or something like that. But that's because they're a little bit like a closed balloon. An unblown up balloon. They're a bit like an umbrella in the rainstorm. You're walking down the street and the rain starts to come out and you keep the umbrella down there, keep the umbrella closed, you're going to get drowned. Unless you open the umbrella and put it up over your head, it's not going to be any good to you. And then it's wonderful. It saves you from the storm. Well, their mind is as closed as the closed umbrella. And they have no intention of opening their mind. And it's not my job or your job or anybody else's job to go around opening people's minds. Because people can't and won't open their minds until they choose to. And if we try to force the issue, then we're not in our own sacred space, if you like. Because we're not honouring their right to be different, and they have a right to be different. They have a right to be silly and stupid, so long as they don't harm anybody else. And they have a right to keep their umbrella closed. They have a right to get drowned if that's what they want to do, providing they don't harm anybody else, because that's the closest they'll probably ever get to sovereignty. Now, fortunately, some of those people do wake up, and when they do, I think it's absolutely wonderful. I've come across a few who have, and it's absolutely fantastic. Well, for the most part, they don't and they won't. But all good ideas are always dismissed at first. Completely ridiculed at first, then they're dismissed, and thirdly, they're accepted. That's what happens with all good ideas. And sovereignty, and the understanding of sovereignty, and the reclaiming of sovereignty, not the claiming, the reclaiming of sovereignty, because you see, we're born with sovereignty. And we've got to reclaim that sovereignty. I keep coming back to it all the time. It's the most sacred word in the English or indeed any language. Sovereignty. Sovereign is who and what you are. And if you stand in your sovereignty, you can feel so proud of what you are, no matter what you do. Once you have your sovereignty, you're within your own power. And it's a wonderful, powerful, magnificent place to be. And you won't be inclined to dismiss anybody in your sovereignty, because you're safe in your own skin. You won't be inclined to try and indoctrinate others, because you're safe in your own skin. You won't be preaching at others, because you're safe in your own skin. But you will be inclined to withdraw from others who want to attack and fight with you about it, or want to call you names like conspiracy theorists or whatever else they come up with. That's their latest cry. And that's a wonderful excuse not to engage in the intellectual understanding of whatever concept is being presented. Because if they had to engage in that, they would very quickly show the weakness of where they're coming from. So they can't. So they have to dismiss. They have to put you down. So for your own sake, don't engage with that. Don't get into other people's soap operas. If people are doing all the soap opera thing, don't engage in that. And talking about soap operas, don't even look at soap operas on TV, because you see, this is designed to get you into a way of thinking that is totally disempowering. Because every time you look at a soap opera, nobody is empowering those soap operas. Everybody's life has been totally screwed up. And there's a purpose behind that. It's a form of indoctrination that life is like that and life is not like that, unless you make it like that by being part of the soap opera. If you're part of the soap opera, you'll have no power, you'll have no integrity, you'll have no peace of mind, and your life won't be worth living. When you're sovereign, your life is sacred, it's magnificent,
and it's beautiful. So there's the two choices.
Tom, we've talked about, I suppose, in a sense, trying to get back control of yourself and how it begins with yourself, and don't look at others to lead you, and how it isn't really good or morally right to try and lead other people either, to allow them to find their own way. So I suppose one of the best ways that you've discussed with me in the past that I think might be scripting. Would you mind elaborating on what scripting is for people and sharing some of your thoughts?
Well, if we look at people, anybody, they're either scripting their life or they're following other people's scripts. Now, look at your own life just for a moment. If you were scripting your life, and I'm not saying you're not, but if you were scripting your life, would you be taking bit parts in other people's life, being said and led by them, being controlled by them, being used and abused and manipulated by them, and being paid a lot less than you're worth? Would that be how you would script your life? I didn't think so either. If you were scripting your life, wouldn't you give yourself the leading role? Wouldn't you put the spotlight on yourself? If you're a man, wouldn't you be reaching out there for the lady playing the leading role, or vice versa? And would you be giving yourself a Mickey Mouse wage? And would you be accepting, you know, the scraps off the table of other people, and they're telling you, patting you on the head, and telling you that's good enough for you, and then half of that taken away in tax as well? I don't think you'd be scripting your life like that, would you? Now, if you're living in a non-scripted life, not a non-scripted life, but a life that's been scripted by the media for you, that you started being allowed to script when you were being preached at in school, maybe in church, maybe by your parents, without any harm being meant by anybody, but that was the mindset that was created. It's a mindset of subservience. And a subservient mind script is a mind script where you're being said and led, i.e. you're the puppet, your life's been scripted for you. You're never going to get a good part from people who are scripting your life, because they keep the good parts for themselves. If you start to script your life, you have every but as much right, every but as much talent, every but as much ability to script your life in as good a way as you see others scripting it. You may have to work at it a little bit. You may have to learn a new skill, or a new trade, or a new profession, or a new something to do that, but it's worth taking the time to do it. It's worth transforming your life to do it. It'll take probably quite a bit of effort in the beginning, because if you're working from a place where there's no script, well, then you're going to have to start writing a script. I don't suggest you start writing the script of the great big top guy straight away, because it's not going to work like that, because you haven't trained yourself to act that part yet. But if you write little improvements in your script every day and in every way, a tiny improvement in your script, that you're going to do something completely different, that you're going to improve the quality of your life, that you're going to say no to people, you're going to make up your own mind, you're going to take control, you're going to decide where you're going to go or where you're not going to do, and really, that's taking back your sovereignty, but you start in small bits at first. You started preparing yourself then to go into the next bit. Say, an actor is going to play a role in a film. He's got to go off and learn the script. Well, you want to start scripting your life. There's a little effort involved, but the reward is incredible, so it's well worth the effort. You're going to have to learn the script. You may well have to write the script. You may well need help to write the script. You may well need a therapist to help you to change your mind and the way you're thinking to write the script. But my God, once you write that script, you can direct it, you can produce it, you can play it, you can run it, you can live it. Ask yourself about those people who are doing very, very well in life and who are definitely scripting their life. Are they better people than you? Are they smarter, more intelligent than you? For the most part, they're not. The big difference is they're scripting their life. And if you start scripting your life, you can transform your life, absolutely transform your life. And there's no point in saying, oh, it's too late, or I'm too old. You can do it at any time. There's no too late, and there's no too old to start scripting your life. Start it in tiny ways at first. Feel the reward of those tiny ways. People say you have to be here, here, and here. Ask yourself, do I really have to be here, here, and here? Wouldn't it be preferred to be there, there, and there?
and give yourself the opportunity of making the choice. So the first thing you do to start scripting your life is start giving yourself more choices. Now, people think in what we call a binary way. Will I, want I, black or white, yes or no, good or bad. That kind of a way, one or two. That's limiting. And that's never a place to script your life from. You give yourself at least six options for everything. So, will I go to such a place or such a place? Well, think of four more besides. Now, just do it in the beginning as an exercise. You don't have to necessarily want to go to any of those other four places, but allow yourself over time to get into the habit of giving yourself six choices for everything. That's a wonderful way to start scripting your life. It's a very simple way to start scripting your life. But the next part of the way to start scripting your life, sit down, look at your work, look at your job, look at your home life, look at how distance you're going to work every morning, look at what you're doing, look at how you're responding and reacting to other people, and look at what you can modify now. The simple things, the small things. Look at what you can modify then on the medium term. And then look at the major script changes, the major parts you can learn to play in the long term. But if you don't start taking the tiny steps today, about the small things, and take out the things you don't want to do and the things you don't need to do right now, then you're never going to get to the medium or the long term. So you better start scripting your life now if you want to have your life, if you want to be in control of your life. Of course, if you're already scripting your life, that's fine. You don't have to do that. But if you are already scripting your life, help others to script their life. Give them a little bit of direction, a little bit of support, above all, a little bit of encouragement. And then others can do. And you're changing the world by helping others in that way. Don't try to push others, or don't try to preach at them, if you like. Don't do any of that. You can't help others unless they want to help themselves. One of the things you'll start off with when you become a therapist, as I did way back, you want to go out and help everybody. And you see people in the street and they need help in such a way. You really want to rush up to them and tell them how you're going to help them. You can't do that. One of the things you're taught is not to do that, because you have no right to impose what you want to do on anybody else unless they request you to do so. Because what you're doing is you're taking their right to script their life away from them. But anybody who wants to script their life, and anybody who wants your help in scripting their life, give them every bit of help you can in every way you can, but never lead them astray. Never take an advantage of them. Because you help them to script their life, they get into a better place in life, they'll be always grateful to you. And if you took advantage of them early on, they won't be of any help to you in the future. You don't take advantage, you help them and support them, they'll do anything for you in the future because they'll be always grateful to you. So please help other people, but only those who want to help.
Perfect. One of the obstacles that people come across is when they first learn this information is all true, they almost deprogram themselves in a sense, and then they go out and they try and share this information rather rapidly with other people, and often they get resistance. For those that are ready for the information or who are asking a few questions, can you possibly give some insights into what might be a nice way or a helpful way to share the information with others?
Well, that's a very interesting question, because that takes me back to a time when I learned how to help people to get rid of asthma as a dis-ease, as opposed to a disease. And I knew how to do it. And I was going across O'Connell Bridge in Dublin one day, and I saw a guy at the other side, right across the street, and I could see by his breathing he was an asthmatic. I wanted to run across that street. And I would say, look, we can help you, we can get rid of that asthma. And it took me quite a while to realize that you can't do that. You're imposing on a person with, even if it's the truth, it's still an imposition. You've got to wait until they come to you with some kind of a question, some kind of a readiness. And then you've got to be careful and give them one step at a time. Because if you give them a whole lot of information in a great big hurry, it causes a shutdown, because the belief systems will click in, the fear will head into place, people move away from what they're afraid of, they move back into the comfort zone, and they're gone back into the little prison, they pull down the shutter, and you're not communicating with them anymore. So communication of sovereignty, for example, has to be taken very gently. And you can do it by a series of questions. Wouldn't you like to be free from those kind of fears? Wouldn't you like to be more comfortable in yourself? Wouldn't it be nice
if you could feel equal to all of those people, wonder what would you have to do to achieve that? Get questions going in their own mind, allow them to come back to you with the questions, and if you can do that, then you can guide them step by step. It's like going up a ladder. You go one step at a time. You take a running jump at that ladder, you smash your face into it, you're going to fall flat on the ground. Well, trying to give too much information, your person you're giving it to will probably run away. So gently, gently is how to do it. There's an old expression, gently, gently, catch a monkey. Well, we don't want to catch any monkeys, but we want to inform people. But we don't want to impose on people. Like, nobody wants a preacher. And when you start imposing your preaching, I remember many years ago, this person came to me with a whole born-again thing, top of the Bible, things like that. And I knew this person 6 months ago would be plastered falling out of a pub. And I thought, where did this come from? This was a kind of a St. Paul on the road to Damascus transformation. And I said, but you've only been at this for 6 months. Why are you thumping it down at me like this? Oh, but I've been saved by the Lord, all these kind of things like that. It's not like that. It's gently, does it? Sovereignty is the God within, if you like.
A question in relation to sovereignty, because when people hear the term, they think it's got to do with royalty or pageantry. How do people become sovereign, and what does it truly mean? Can we expand on that a little bit?
We could. Take a cat. The cat goes out into the back garden. The cat is king in that jungle, in the cat's own mind. And that cat is happy, and that's all that matters. Now, we human beings can learn a lot from cats. Now, if we want to become sovereign, we got to have self-love, self-respect. And that's been whittled away from the very beginning, from the day we first put our hand up in school and asked to go to the toilet. Self-love, there's no self-love, self-respect in having to, please, may I go to the toilet? That's ridiculous. No child should have that imposed on them. And a lot of the other things that happen in school shouldn't be imposed. In fact, I'm all for homeschooling. But anyway, back to the question, how do we do that? There's a very simple exercise. If a person wants to get into the state of mind where they can become sovereign, I would suggest that they look in the mirror first thing every morning before they do anything else. Doesn't matter how you look, doesn't matter how you feel, just look in that mirror, it won't hurt you. If you feel uncomfortable doing it, that'll go away after a while. And you say to the mirror, as though addressing your image, you're talking to the image, because you have a thing called a self-image. And the self-image is how you portray yourself to the world. When you look in that mirror, say to the image, I love and approve of you unconditionally. You'll feel very uncomfortable in the beginning when you do that, I promise. And that's because the opposite has been happening all the time. When people look in the mirror, oh my God, look at the state of me this morning. Oh my God, I've got a spot. Oh my God, I got this, that, the other thing. So they're criticizing themselves all the time. So when you turn around and say, I love and approve of you unconditionally, it's the very opposite to the programming that's been fed in through their entire life. Now, it takes a little bit of time to change that programming. So that must be done first thing every morning, last thing every night. Now, the words have power, and the words are vitally important. And there's a very well written book in every other respect that says something that keeps people stuck instead. You look in the mirror and say, I love and approve of you unconditionally. Now, the book I'm thinking of says, I love and approve of myself as I am. That means I'm stuck, and I love being stuck, and I'm going to stay stuck. That's no good. I love and approve of you unconditionally leaves everything completely open. And there's room for change, there's room for improvement, there's room for advancement. That's like putting a deposit in a bank on a daily basis. And bit by bit, within 3 to 4 weeks, it builds up to a critical point where you tip over from the self-criticism into the self-love, self-approval. And when you get into the self-love, self-approval from the self-criticism, you're ready to become sovereign then, because you're strong enough inside to become sovereign, and you begin to vibrate with the frequency of sovereignty.
Back in the chair a bit, I can see you better. Sorry, Tom.
And you vibrate then with the frequency of sovereignty. And when you do that, you're ready to feel it, be it, express it, love it, enjoy it, and be empowered by it.
spoke in relation to actions of sovereignty. How would one go about planning for good actions in one's life?
Well, that's a little bit like asking me how a scriptwriter, a producer and a director would go about putting a movie together. Think of your life as a movie, because in many senses it is. Now, you're either scripting that and directing that life, or you're getting little bit parts in other people's lives. If you have to run to work at 9 o'clock or 8 o'clock or whatever o'clock every morning, somebody else is controlling that part of your script. If you have to dress according to what you think society suggests, well then the whole lot of society is scripting that part of your life. And there are so many other areas. Basically, it's simple. We are either scripting our life or our life is being scripted for us. If our life is being scripted for us, we're getting bit parts. We'll never be happy, we'll never be sovereign in that place, we'll never be comfortable, and we'll never feel satisfied, we'll never feel fulfilled. That's the word I'm looking for. In that state. Whereas if we start scripting our own life, it's about personal fulfillment. It's about back to personal sovereignty again, living your life as you choose to live your life. And when you're living your life from a sovereign place now, are you going to give yourself bit parts? I don't think so. Would you give yourself the starring role? I think so. Would you put a spotlight in you and run towards that person across the mountain that's the love of your life? I think you would. Would you be living in a little hovel, or would you be living in a nice place? But once you start creating those things in your mind, from a sovereign perspective, bit by bit, they become your reality. Because what you perceive and believe is what you eventually achieve.
Excellent. You talked about the importance of people being comfortable writing their own script and envisioning their own script. Can you possibly speak a little bit about how, I suppose, the system or the media keep people from writing their own script, or what are some of their tactics, or would you mind just elaborating on why people are fearful of writing their own script?
Well, every time you read the newspaper, look at TV, listen to the radio, there's a media emphasis on keeping you feeling small. The lower you are, the more insecure you are, the more garbage you'll buy, the more pills you'll buy, the more this you'll buy, the more the other thing, the more kind of garbage you put around yourself to try and protect yourself. You see, sovereignty comes from within, and if you have no sovereignty within, you put a lot of garbage around yourself to try and protect yourself. So there's a media prerogative through the advertising world, and through a whole lot of emphasis from the corporations that pay for the advertisements, to keep you buying. You see, if you listen to them in the radio, they don't say, we're talking to the sovereign people of Ireland today, or the sovereign people of any place else. They talk about consumers. Consumer's a slave, let's be honest about it. They want you to consume more and more, so they get more and more of your money away from you. They want to enslave you more and more and more and more. Consumerism is total, absolute, utter slavery. So you make up your mind, you're either going to be a consumer, a slave, or you're going to be a sovereign. Now, this consumer slave is never going to be happy. The consumer slave is never going to be fulfilled, because no matter how much of their stuff you buy, it's not going to satisfy that powerful need, want, desire on the inside. The only thing that satisfies that is your relationship to what's on the inside.
So, Tom, you mentioned something very interesting earlier on. You mentioned the age of 12 as being key and childhood. Would you mind elaborating for people where it can all go wrong before the age of 12?
Well, it's all gone wrong long before the age of 12. The Jesuits recognized that a long time ago. Give me a child for the first 6 years of his life, and then I will tell you what the rest of his life is going to be about, because he's well indoctrinated during that period of time. You see, from the moment we go into school, and long before that, because our poor unfortunate parents have been indoctrinated as well, and they feed that indoctrination onto us as truth and reality. And their fears and their belief systems are fed into us. For example, If you grow up in, say, Saudi Arabia, you're going to grow up as a young Muslim. If you grow up in Kentucky, you're going to grow up as a Protestant. If you grow up in Ireland, you're probably going to grow up as a Catholic. Well, it depends on what part of Ireland you grow up in. And so why are we growing up with these particular religions and belief systems? Because they have been inculcated into us from our parents, and they pass on their belief systems. That's an insidious thing. So children, when they're left alone, they have fabulous, wonderful, magnificent dreams. The little bit of this we know about comes from what we see in beautiful children's stories. And in, if you talk to children, ask them about their dreams, they're fabulous, they're magnificent, they're expansive. There's no limit to what they can do. If they were allowed to continue with those dreams, there would be no limit to what they would be able to do and what they would be able to achieve. But what happens to those dreams? Oh, you couldn't do that. No, you can't do that. They're put down every time they express those dreams. They're sneered at, they're laughed at, they're ridiculed for their dreams. And eventually they learn to stop dreaming. And from the moment they stop dreaming, it's very easy to control them. It's very easy to enslave them. So the first thing that happens is the destruction of the dream. The dream is related to potential and sovereignty. And when that's destroyed, potential and sovereignty are largely destroyed. Now you can mold that child into whatever you like. And I promise you, the molders, they'll want to mold it into anything magnificent. They want it to mold it into something that's compliant, obedient, enslaved. Because now they can maintain control over there.
But Tom, when people hear this information, they will dismiss it as a conspiracy theory because they simply can't believe that people or institutions could actually be this scheming. Could you elaborate a little bit on this, please?
Well, that's very simple to elaborate, and they should read a bit of his story, history. Before, we had a system called feudalism. And if that wasn't one hell of a conspiracy, that's well documented throughout the entire world, that kept people in slavery, subservience, and every kind of misery, and fed people into the war machines, they went out and got killed. And that was the system then. That was a conspiracy by the people who were in control. There's no question about it. Nobody asked any questions about it. Tell me what has changed. Then we had feudalism, which was built around land and ownership of land. The ownership of land actually related in their minds to the ownership of people who were slaves and serfs. Now today, we've still got feudalism, or it's returned. Now it's corporate feudalism. The corporation controls the flow of money. The corporation controls the availability of work and jobs and the conditions related to jobs. The religions control the belief systems, and the government is a kind of little place in between both of them, squares a bit by both, because if they don't get the money from the corporations from taxes, they can't survive, and if they don't have the religions to keep the people a bit subservient, they can't control them. So it's not so much a conspiracy as a system that's comfortable with itself because of all the benefits it's deriving. So to dismiss it as a conspiracy theory is a bit stupid. It's stupid because the person who's saying that is probably very much enslaved in the middle of it, and so-called so enslaved in their mind that they're frightened to open their eyes to see the truth. Because you'll see them running off to some church on a Sunday. You'll see them running to the pharmacy on Monday for their pills that the doctor gave them that are probably wrecking their liver. You'll see them running to the job on Monday morning and coming home. You see them looking at their pay packet with dissatisfaction at the end of the week or the end of the month. They're completely enslaved. Now, it doesn't matter whether you call it a conspiracy or whether you call it anything else. It's reality. But it's not the truth. It's not related to sovereignty. And you can be still become sovereign, as I described, and get away from most of that. The only security, you see, it's built around security. Say, oh, if I don't keep this job, and if I don't do that, and if I don't do the other thing, oh, I won't be able to survive. Well, how do you know? Have you tried anything else? The other one is, oh, if I don't go running down to the church every Sunday, I'll burn in hellfire for all eternity. So they're going to church to buy fire insurance. And there's so many other examples like that. The real sovereign grows up because, you see, these are childhood fears. These are insecurities. The insecurity of a 12-year-old. The 12-year-old has every right and entitlement to feel insecure because they're dependent on their parents and the rest, and adults in society and education and the rest to keep them going. When you grow up, you should be independent. And the truth of independent is self-love, self-approval, and out of that, sovereignty. When you're there, you've nothing to be afraid of because you can create your own self-sufficiency. This is the hardest thing for anybody to grasp. And I'm not suggesting that they dump everything immediately. I'm suggesting to take one tiny step at a time. One tiny step. And they can start doing that. The first step is to look in that mirror, creating the conditions to feel good about themselves. The second step is to recognize themselves as a sovereign. The third step is to start scripting your life. And the fourth step then is find ways, simple ways at first, to step back as much as possible from the system. Those four simple steps will give you a lot of sovereignty. And I would suggest, if you have any self-respect, that you do that.
Tom, one of the things which I think is quite interesting about sovereignty is quite often people that you would have respect for or are highly intelligent don't seem to grasp the importance or the relevance of this information. Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
I can indeed, but first of all, who said I had any respect for them? The people who don't want to know about this have a damn good vested interest in keeping it. The guy who's a professor in college, that goddamn college shouldn't exist, because most of what he's probably teaching is absolute rubbish anyway. Lies for the most part. I mean, anybody who takes a degree in what we call the humanities and things like that, it has no practical benefit in life. It doesn't teach you to be a sovereign human being. It doesn't teach you to have love and respect for yourself. So that's one example. The doctor, he's not going to say, don't take my medicine, because he needs you to keep coming back to get his little dividend. And the system, the people who have comfortable positions and are benefiting from the enslavement by having a role someplace in the middle where they're a next step up the ladder from you are quite comfortable where they are. So they're in a comfort zone. It's got nothing to do with intelligence. It's got to do with comfort. More important than this so-called intelligence is self-respect. And if you really look at them, let's take, okay, you call them, what did you call them again?
People you have respect for.
Well, people we had respect for in the past were the bankers. The bank manager was God. The teacher was God. And the priest was God's servant talking to you from the mouth of God. And the lawyer, oh my God, he knew everything, didn't he? Well, now the lawyer's running away with the money. The bankers have already got the money. A lot of the teachers, very suspect. The priests, well, they have been totally discredited, and the doctors are giving out the pills of death every day. So, I mean, why would you respect them? There's nothing to respect. The respect is about yourself. You must respect yourself, love yourself, approve of yourself, and create sovereignty from within. That's the only respect. Don't give away your power by respecting somebody else. Don't disrespect them either. Treat them as an equal. You don't have to disrespect anybody, but see them for what they are and question who they are and what they're doing without disrespecting them and without getting into any controversy with them. You don't need to get into any conflict or controversy with them. You have to ask yourself those questions within. Where are they in relation to me? How are they affecting my life? And how can I make myself independent of their effect in my life? Sovereign from their effect in my life. And then the only person that is important for you to respect is yourself, and treat everybody else as an equal, and then there's no conflict.
So Tom, at the moment, to all intents and purposes, we're in some form of construct which tells us how to think and what we which way we should act, etc. And the mind, for most people, doesn't really have a firewall in that they accept a lot of this information unconditionally. What would be the best way to protect oneself against this onslaught?
That sounds like a bit of a conspiracy theory to me. The best way to protect ourselves against that construct, that onslaught, and onslaught is the best word for it, is questions. Question everything. How, where, what, when, why. Somebody a long time ago had a little poem. It said, I had 6 faithful serving men who taught me all I know. Their names are where and what and when and why and who and how. And if you take that on board, always ask questions. Ask questions to yourself. Is this appropriate for me? Is this going to improve the quality of my life? Is there a better way? In fact, with regard to everything, we bind ourselves into a binary way of thinking. Will I, want I, yes or no, black or white, today or tomorrow, good or bad, this kind of a thing. There's 2 choices there all the time. A little bit like a computer, but a computer knows how to work with that binary system in a better way. We don't. Once we ask ourselves those 2 questions, we are now reduced to 2 answers. We were never meant to be like that. That's part of the conditioning system that started when we put the hand up. Can we go to the toilet? Yes or no? It starts there every time. We should ask ourselves 6 questions about every choice that comes up for us. It's a fantastic way of breaking the mold, if you like. Ask yourself 6 questions. They can seem to be very silly, if you like. It doesn't make any difference. About every choice, should I go to the shops? Well, that's a yes or no to most people. Well, should I go to that shop or should I go to that shop? Will I go by car or will I go by walking? And ask yourself, many, will I get this, will I get that? Break it down and you'll find that there's a whole lot of richness in the answers you give yourself as opposed to the impoverishment of the yes or no, the binary way of thinking. So ask yourself 6 questions about every choice that comes into your life. And that will enrich you beyond your wildest dreams. Well, when you start getting an onslaught of information from the media that seem to have had no relevance to what's going on, and it's contrary to the truth, let's face it. For example, they started telling us a few years ago that there was going to be water shortages, that there was a crisis about water. They didn't tell you that, for example, in the Dublin area, about 60% of the water that goes through the system never gets through to the person's sink, simply because the dam system is so leaky, because they've never bothered their asses to get off and repair it. So they're telling us there's a shortage of water, yet they can afford to water the water table, if you like, with a whole lot of extra water. And telling people there's a whole lot of water shortage, there's no desert here, there's a whole lot of rain coming down, there's never a water shortage, there's a water supply shortage. They don't tell us they're putting poison into the water with fluoride and all that jazz. Now, if you go back to the time they started making this big thing way back in the 50s, people have told me about it, where they had this thing about the teeth and tooth decay and all that, and they built up a whole conditioning for the people to accept the fluoride in the water. It was attacked at the time, and they barely got it through. Now they're starting telling us that there's a shortage of water, there's a water crisis, not enough water to go around. They're making this nonsense about having to bring water from the Shannon. They don't need to do any of those things. What they need to do is get us into a mindset that we accept and allow them to put water meters and start charging us from the water that falls from the sky that's free for everybody. So there's always a... Now that we have to be able to bypass that, because they're step by step, tiny steps at a time, getting beyond our resistance system. You see, if I put up a great resistance, if I put up a great big thing from the very beginning, say everybody has to pay for the water from tomorrow, huge resistance, everybody will resist it. But if I insidiously build up this the requirement over a period of time, there's going to be a terrible shortage, and they're doing you a favour by charging you for the water. Bit by bit, they're getting through. Now, we don't have a firewall to block that kind of insidious, step-by-step, sneaky, creeping way of getting beyond our natural protective system. So we don't have a firewall against that. We've got to build it up. So every time any authority starts preaching anything new or starts suggesting anything new, question it immediately. And then in your mind, follow the money trail. Who's going to benefit financially from that? And how much more are they going to get out of your pocket? And for what they've taken out of your pocket, will there be any benefits for you? You'll find no, they won't. And if you ask yourself every time there's any new agenda presented to you, where is this leading to? Where is the money trail going to? You'll create a money trail firewall. And that's the best firewall to build. So you start creating a firewall by asking questions. And the ultimate question is, where is the money trail leading to? The minute any new agenda is put to you, and there will be more, because bit by bit, they're encroaching more and more into people's freedoms and sovereignty. Because the system has become so greedy and it's become so top-heavy that it's no longer able to finance itself. It's breaking down. And because of that, they need more and more money from you and me to try and prop it up. Well, that system has to be allowed to break down because it's reached way beyond its sell-by date. And it's time for a new system based on local communities working in harmony together, groups of sovereigns working together. That's a whole other story, but that's the future of humankind. It's already been established in Russia under what they call the domain system, set up by this man called Vladimir Megre, under the instructions of this lady called Anastasia. Those Anastasia books, by the way, I suggest everybody read them. Then they will understand how sovereigns work in harmony together in communities.
But Tom, Ireland has struggled for sovereignty for 800 years. Where are we now?
Well, we're not any more sovereign than we were in any time during that 800 years. In fact, the enemy was easily recognisable before. Now the enemy has gone native, if you like. So native politicians going with cap in hand without any sovereignty within themselves to Brussels. And more than delighted to give away our sovereignty for the little bit of 30 pieces of silver they're getting for that. Before any of this goes back 800 years, we had a system called the Tuatha system, which were small local communities with the local chief, and each system was somewhat secure in and of itself and somewhat sovereign in and of itself, and there was respect for the individuals and their roles in society. That was a form of sovereignty, probably not fully evolved, but heading in the right direction if it had been allowed to. Of course, that couldn't be allowed because that was going to threaten all of the feudal system that was building up in Europe at the time, and we had to be wiped, and we were. Nowadays, there has been attempts at creating sovereignty in the meantime in Ireland. Way up in Glencullum Kill, Father Matt Dyer, way back in the 60s, I think it was, set up local co-ops and got fantastic resurgence in a community where everybody was immigrating and created local work and local everything. When he passed on, they let the whole damn thing die because it needed leadership that we don't have at the moment, because all leadership is filtered away and it dies when the child puts the hand up to go to the toilet again. And very few people have that kind of foresight. There was a thing called Muintir na Tíre over 100 years ago by Canon Hayes from Banshee in Tipperary. And that was Muintir na Tíre, people of the country, to create cooperatives around the country. And they started doing wonderful works. And again, the old system comes in and starts taking that. There was the cooperative creamery system in Ireland, which was wonderful. And now they've all been sneakily bought out by the big corporations. That should never have happened. And if people could have seen what was going on, that was an insidious build-up. They would pay for that. They would pay very dearly for that. Because those you see, you were part of the cooperative. You looked after yourself and your community. Those corporations don't give a damn about you or your community, and you will pay dearly because you're now their slave. There was then the credit union system that the central bank is trying to dismantle at the moment. So each time we build up one of those systems, the corporate feudal system comes in and buys it out, or in some way eliminates or demolishes it. Now, we've got to build up sovereignty from within. In fact, on the 19th of January every year, the Sovereign Seal, which is a harp, the symbol of Ireland, is turned in the Mansion House by the president of the Irish Republican Brotherhood, Billy Maguire. And this is a small but very, very important ceremony. Now, symbolism is important in relation to sovereignty because it gives you a focal point. And on the 21st of January every year, the Sovereign Seal, which is a harp symbol, is turned in the Mansion House by the president of the IRB, Billy Maguire. And this is growing year after year and it's getting bigger and bigger. Interesting thing about that is the authorities in this country refuse to go along with it. They kind of try to ignore it. They kind of try to say it didn't happen. Well, the funny thing about it is that's our Independence Day and it's not celebrated. Now, if you ask an Irish person what their Independence Day is, they don't know. Because nobody in that school where they were asked to put their hand up to go to the toilet ever told them their Independence Day. That's appalling. The Americans know it's the 4th of July and the French know Bastille Day and so on and so forth. We have a right to know our Independence Day as well. And it's the 21st of January, and its Sovereign Seal is turned every year. And I think this is something that should be emulated right throughout the country and done in every town council, every county council, every school, and every place else. You might say this is ridiculous, but if you go to the United States, and I lived there for some time, every morning the children do stand up and they do a salutation to the flag. Frankly, first time I saw that, it looked a little bit Nazi to me. We don't have to go that far, but to turn our sovereign seal once a year, to recognize that there is a sovereignty there, to recognize the story with it, not the his story, the story with it, the truth with it, and to participate in it and be proud of it, and to participate with our own sovereignty within it. Because if we don't do that, everything gets whittled away. For example, the GAA at the moment, they're giving out a trinket instead of an All-Ireland medal to our greatest athletes who fight every year, and they put fantastic work, fantastic training, incredible work. It's the greatest non-corporate structure in the world, but it's run by a corporation. Because the crowd in GAA headquarters don't seem to know anything about it. They've got rid of the All-Ireland medal. Now you get a corporate trinket instead. This is appalling for a whole year of training and all the glory and the magic and the history and everything about the background of it. Like, for example, Hayes's Hotel is running to rack and ruin. It wouldn't cost a lot to buy that. The GAA are hesitating. They're trying to avoid it as much as possible. That's not the GAA. The heart and the spirit of the GAA would never do that. They would raise funds in every club in Ireland. They'd buy that in no time. But the crowd in Croke Park are a corporation. They're just another feudal corporation. This has to be taken back for the people. It has to become sovereign again because it was a sovereign organisation run by a whole lot of independent sovereigns. Now it's run by a corporation. So we've got to start taking back our power from the corporations. We've got to start creating our local cooperative societies again, like the creameries back in those days, and like producing our own food in a localised basis and creating cooperation and cooperatives. And instead of being run by a board of directors who are answerable to people we don't know, who are stockholders in that, and their little dividend at the end of the year determines how that company is run or not. That's not the way to run an organization. It's about people. It's about the individual. It's about the flesh and blood human being. It's about the sovereign human being, not about bloody corporations. And until we recognize that, we'll never be sovereign. When we recognize that and start taking action, then we start to gain our sovereignty. Then we start to become independent. Then we start to become happy, empowered within ourselves. And if we're not happy and empowered within ourselves, we're a damn slave. So it's either slavery or sovereignty. There's two choices. You can make four more. I suggest you do. But start with those two. Because I said there should be six choices for everything. So that's where we're at the moment. We're at the crossroads because everything is changing. Because you see the corporations are breaking down. Because they've become top heavy. The system doesn't really work anymore. While it's growing, it's working. When it's reached maturity, it starts to go backward. And it's long past maturity, i.e. its sell-by date. So now we got to start creating a whole new system. This is a wonderful time and a wonderful opportunity to do it from a place of personal sovereignty for every individual human being. We're human beings, not human doings. We're not slaves.